a special guest I want to announce today. We have Commissioner Richard Rockchild. Commissioner? You don't have to clap after each one because there might be a meter here. Commissioner Steve Wands. I don't know, was that higher? Was there more applause? I don't know. We have a lot of mayors here. I'd like to introduce the mayors here. We have Westminster Mayor Kevin Hutz. I'm still Kevin. Hampstead's Mayor Chris Nevin. Chris. New Winter's Mayor Neil Roop. Representing Congressman Andy Harris is Mary O'Keefer. I saw Mary somewhere. Why do companies come to Carroll County? They come to Carroll County for our labor. And number two, they come because of our education. And our education partners are all here today. We have Dr. James Ball, the president of Carroll Community College. Dr. Roger Casey, the president of McDaniel College. Steve Guthrie, the superintendent at Carroll County Public Schools. As you're going to see, our program and our deals have been very successful. We couldn't do it without our partners at DBED. We have a lot of DBED partners here. I'd like to introduce them. They're extremely important to us. Tim Dole, the head of finance for the state. Tim? If you need money, see Tim. That's why he's keeping a low profile. Mary D. Fernando, who really runs the place for Tim. Yeah. Tim Murphy, back there in the back. Carl Lacey, the manufacturing rep. Carl, thank you. Whoa. And then, of course, we have the famous Mike McMullen, the president of the Chamber of Commerce. Mike. We have partners in the towns, and I saw I saw Nancy McCormick. Nancy from Tawny Town. And the future of all of us is here too, the Academy of Finance students. They're here again this year, and could all the Academy students please stand? They're here in the back. Students of Financial Service Program and the opportunity to earn the NAF endorsement as Academy of Finance graduate. I want to thank Mike Shank again and M&T Bank for their ongoing support and sponsorship of Academy attendance at the event. Mike or M&T or Jurgen somewhere. What I'd like to do is take a few minutes. Everybody says, what's going on in Carroll County? We have a lot of brokers here. What I thought I'd do is take maybe 5 minutes to talk about the highlights, what's going on locally, and Audubon's going to talk about more of micro. Put it up? Oh, you're not going to put it up? I guess I got to say it. Carroll County is ranked fifth in the state, the unemployment at 4.9%, and the state average is 5.6. I can tell you that we always talk about the assessable base. The assessable base has grown to 13%. In the last 3 years, it's gone from 11% to 13%. Some of our major announcements is Fuchs, North America. Chris Nevin's worked really hard in bringing Fuchs to Hampstead. They're going to create 160 jobs. The company is going to invest $25 million and build a 240,000 square foot building. Most of you know he's Baltimore Spicer. Chris, thank you for all your effort. And they're going to start, they're going to break ground on June 23rd. It's going to take a year to build it. So Fuchs, North America. Penguin Random House. They closed 5 other locations and they're investing millions of dollars in the locations that were here. They only have two locations now in the United States. Westminster here and one in Illinois. Carlisle, etc. moved from New York and they created over 80 jobs. Then they bought the old work the old Murata building, which was vacant for 4 years. So if you go by, you'll see Carlisle, etc. They make women's clothes. Warfield. I think every year someone has stood up here and said, gee, we're going to do Warfield. Well, Warfield has a contract. Warfield's going to settle in July. And they're going to be a developer. They plan to do mixed-use complex consisting of residential, office, and retail, and put $1 million on the bottom line for Carroll County. Ellersburg Commons, the redevelopment of Carrolltown Mall. It's a $50 million project, and the anchor is going to be the Super Walmart, which is 187,000 square feet, and you'll see the building went up now. Elite Screens, Walter Patton, he's worked on the deal for the second Murata building, and when it's on the airport. And Elite Screens from California has purchased the building. They're going to be opening up shortly. And I can tell you, contracts have been submitted on the two former General Dynamics buildings, one of them in the Tech Center and one of them in West Branch Trade Center. They're both manufacturers and are going to create over 400 jobs, and they should settle in about 6 months. Small business. The Carroll's Business Path Partners with John Wheatman. John, my partner in economic development, why don't you? They're sitting next to each other, John Eaton and Tim Bill, right next to each other. To see them. John is a navigator. He's had 314 participants in the first two quarters, and it resulted in 12 business starts. So that's 12 new companies have opened up in Carroll County and 31 jobs. John likes again. The Carroll Innovation Center in Overton offers state-of-the-art amenities, conferencing, and high-speed Wi-Fi. The center has been real successful, leasing 87% of its fixed office space and 52% of its cubicle space. And if they also have drop-in spaces, you can rent an office, you can drop in for the day. Just see John, he'll take care of you. New developments, the planning continues in the Mannery Business Park. It's a park that is 254 acres. The park's gonna be a campus. It's a $30 million project. It's going to generate 900,000 square feet, and DBetter's our partner in that. That's on Route 27, 2 miles from Interstate 70. So we're real excited about that. It's going to be in the town of Mount Airy. The North Carroll Business Park, Fuchs is buying 31 acres in the front, and we have about 54 acres on going up 30. We're going to start developing that project. And also, DBet is a partner with us on that. With all these projects in the pipeline and what we're talking about, these projects are going to generate $5 million in new tax revenues by 2018. $5 million. Commissioners, you listen to that? You have $5 million for all these projects by 2018. Carroll County, it's the right place and the right time to come here. We couldn't do anything that we do without partners. We talked about partners. Our partner has been there for us all the time is BB&T Bank. Our president here is Chris Rupert of Marketing. Chris, can you want to come forward and introduce Audubon? Thank you.
Good morning. Thank you for having me this morning. Thanks, Jack, for the introduction. It's good to hear so many positive things going on here in Carroll County. Thank you to the Economic Development Office for giving BB&T the opportunity to come up here this morning and introduce Mr. Basu. This is the 14th year he's been in Carroll County and the fifth year we've had the opportunity to sponsor this event. This is the largest group of attendees we've had in about 5 years, and that's a tribute to Mr. Basu's reputation and presentations. I would also like to recognize several of my associates from BB&T and our advisory board who are here this morning. Thank you for coming out. Supporting this event is a part of BB&T's commitment to helping our clients achieve economic success and financial security by being part of the community. We all get better together. I've learned many things from my clients over the years. One of those things is that they prefer to work on their business and not necessarily on their banking. However, it is a critical piece of their business, and if they want to be successful, they need to make it an important part of their business considerations. I want to thank many of the clients that we have here today and invite any potential clients to talk with us or take a phone call from one of my associates. BB&T has been named numerous times for many outstanding products and services, including our wealth management capabilities, treasury services, and the day-to-day services received in the branches, just to name a few. I'm confident that a conversation and relationship with BB&T can help your business and being successful. And now for Mr. Basu. I'm not going to read his long and impressive resume in the program. I would simply say that he is an expert in all things economics. Mr. Basu.
Thank you very much. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Thank you so much for having me. I do not take the invitation for granted. I think this is our 14th year, but I don't take the invitation for granted. I'm so happy when I get the phone call or the email saying that, you know, you are welcome back for one more year. These are one-year contracts. But in any case, it's a privilege to be with you today. So what are we going to do today? What we've done for many years now, we're going to talk about the economy. This year's presentation is entitled The Pit and the Pendulum. It was a short story written by Edgar Allan Poe and first published in 1842, subsequently turned into a movie, 1961, starring, among others, Vincent Price. In fact, the theme of the presentation is horror. Even though the outlook is not particularly horrible, that's just the theme of the presentation. But it's important to note that even though Jack and others are able to deliver good news, including in a Carroll County context right now, it's important to remember that all horror stories actually start out quite well. It's often the story of a young girl who buys a lovely, albeit secondhand doll that she nurtures tenderly until it murders her. A story of a group of young people very excited to visit Chernobyl, and how could that end badly? But in any case, right now the data look pretty good. And so even though the theme is horror, the outlook is certainly not horrible. As always, I'll start out with a very brief discussion of the global economy. I'll quickly taper down into national economic data. I'll then share with you data specific to Maryland and Carroll County and other parts of Maryland. We will have time for questions and answers at the end of this session, and so welcome. Thank you very much, and let me begin with that primer on the global economy. And we are coming back from the dead. Despite all the bad news that we hear from various parts of the world, the fact of the matter is that the global economy continues to manifest forward momentum. According to the World Bank last year, the global economy expanded 2.6%. The forecast for the current year, 3.0%. Admittedly, not fabulous performance. As in a typical year, the global economy expands closer to 4% in real, meaning inflation-adjusted terms. That said, there is forward momentum, and of course, in some parts of the world more than in others. Here's a listing of the 20 fastest and 20 slowest growing economies on the planet. Not all of you can see this text, but I won't spend too much time on the text itself. But the left-hand columns are populated by the 20 fastest growing economies in the world last year. These data come from the International Monetary Fund. The right-hand column is populated with the 20 slowest growing economies on the planet. You might ask the question, Anibal, what was the fastest growing economy in 2014? And that would be our dear old friends in Turkmenistan. And you might be asking the question, Anibal, how are the Turkmen doing it? Is this not just a nation of 5.2 million people, capital Ashgabat, currency the manat, 24.6 years, the average age of women at first childbirth? But you're saying, Anibal, we know all that. Why were they able to grow more than 10% last year? Is this not just an agrarian society supported by ancient modes of irrigation? It is, but they also have hefty oil and natural gas reserves. And you should not allow the fact that oil prices this morning opened at $53 a barrel to convince you that the demand for productive inputs into production is shrinking. In fact, that's not true. The world economy is growing. The number of people driving each and every day is rising. So why are energy prices falling? Well, largely because of all the investments the world has made in producing more of those productive inputs. And a lot of those investments have taken place naturally in the natural resource-intensive environments of the world. Many of those environments are in Africa, and that's why if you can see this, you'll see that regionally, Africa dominates this list, and when it's not Africa, it's often Central Asia, where you'll find plentiful supplies of oil and natural gas. And so natural resources, very much a theme among many of the fast-growing countries in the world. In the right-hand column, there's another theme here, but it's subtle. Let's see if you can see it. These are the slowest-growing economies on the planet. Europe. Do you see it? It doesn't just jump right out at you, but it's there. No surprise that the global economy can only manage roughly 3% growth this year. When the Europeans are struggling, the global economy can only expand so quickly as the European economy in the aggregate is even larger than the U.S. economy. Now, speaking of the U.S. is in either column here. The United States is reflected on this chart. Here again are data from the International Monetary Fund. However, these data pertain to growth prospects for 2015, the standing forecast from the International Monetary Fund regarding projections of growth in 2015. And I won't walk through all of this, but again, you can see more weakness expected in Europe, the euro area, the 18 nations that use the euro as their primary currency, only expect to grow 1.2% this year. The French and the Italians expect to grow less than 1% this year. The Canadian outlook is for 2.3% growth, though of course nobody cares. And then the American outlook is 3.6%. Hey, that's pretty good. And probably too optimistic for reasons we'll get into. But we are only through 3+ months of the year, so we're relatively early in the calendar year, and yet already the International Monetary Fund and the World Bank have downgraded their respective forecasts for global economic growth, but have upgraded their outlook for America. And there is this notion of decoupling, that the U.S. economy is so large, that the U.S. consumer is such a force, that if the U.S. consumer is able to spend, then America can continue to expand, even though the balance of the world economy is struggling. Some other stories from other parts of the world, the Chinese economy is expected to grow less than 7% this year, the first time in many years that would happen if that came to pass. The Indian economy now expected to grow more than 6% this year, so the Chinese and Indian growth differential has very much closed. In fact, if you look at the BRIC nations, Brazil, Russia, India, and China, India by far has the best outlook among those countries. The Russian economy is expected to shrink significantly this year, and of course, they deserve that. Now, let's take a step back. We have completed now not quite 6 years of economic recovery. We'll complete 6 years of economic expansion in June. In that month, we'll therefore begin our 7th year of economic expansion. What does that mean? Well, among other things, that the current recovery is longer than the average post-World War II recovery, which is typically in the range of 4.5 to 5 years. And yet, you'll find many Americans who are still not convinced their recovery has even begun. A recent survey by NBC News, and they have, of course, no credibility as they gave it to Brian Williams, but that survey indicated that 57% of Americans still think we're in recession, and other surveys indicate around 50%. Now, granted, those proportions have been falling recently as the economic expansion has continued, but a lot of people do not feel convinced that a recovery is underway. And one of the reasons for this is that the gains from the recovery have been very much concentrated in the hands of a relative few. Ask yourselves who's really prospered during this economic recovery, typically people associated with financial assets. I mean, what's really come back since the financial crisis took full hold of the economy in 2008, stock prices and corporate profits. I'll give you a statistic from 2013. I don't have a 2014 statistic, nobody does. But in 2013, corporate profits as a percentage of gross domestic product equaled 10%. That was an all-time record. The previous record had been achieved in 2012, and before that, 1929. It's rare for corporations to be this profitable, and of course, stock prices, no surprise, have tended to rise higher. Today, as you know, it's got up. The Dow Jones this morning will open at 18,057.65. The S&P 500 will open at 2102.06. The NASDAQ will open up at 4995.98. These are, I don't know if you follow the markets very much, but the point is these are all at or near record highs. The stock market has done extraordinarily well, I think you'd agree. If you had invested $1 in U.S. equities in March of 2009, you'd have almost $3 today. What hasn't come back completely? Home prices. Home prices in much of the country, at least through mid-year last year, were still below the pre-recession peak. Income growth, as everyone knows, has been very slow in real terms. And the number of jobs created by the U.S. economy, despite the recent uptick in job creation, last month notwithstanding, despite that, the number of jobs supported by the U.S. economy is roughly the same number as supported in late 2007 when the recession began. And that's, of course, where the middle class lives. Incomes, jobs, housing, that's not where the recovery has been profound. The recovery has been profound in corporate profits and stock prices. And again, what that does is that concentrates the gains from the recovery. Only 47% of American families own stock, by the way. And much of that is held indirectly in the form of 401ks, 403bs, pensions, so on and so forth. And often these holdings are quite small. And so the gains, as I say, have been very much concentrated. Now, one of the complaints about the recovery today is that it's been concentrated in part because not a lot of people have sought to participate in it. So for instance, The U.S. labor force participation rate last month was 62.7%. That's roughly a 37-year low. But the data I'm showing you here do not pertain to people who have left the U.S. labor market or refused to contemplate entering it, meaning people who are disengaged for whatever reason. These data pertain to the most engaged people in the U.S. labor market, the full-time U.S. worker. And what I've graphed for you here is median weekly earnings, what they take home each week. And what does this tell you? That median weekly earnings have not bounced back to their cyclical peak, and that median weekly earnings are roughly where they were 13 or 14 years ago. So a lot of people do not certainly feel as if the recovery has been particularly strong. And again, as I say, some people don't feel that it's actually a recovery at all. You may have heard, however, recently about Walmart, McDonald's, TJ Maxx, The Gap, and other significant companies raising pay for entry-level workers. And you know, there's also been some increases in minimum wages in various parts of the country as well. And we are starting to see some wage inflation. I'll talk about unemployment rates in a moment. This is a graph of the employment cost index. I've not shown this graph to you in previous years, so I want to walk through this a little bit. This blue-colored line represents the year-over-year percentage change in the cost of employee benefits. Now, you'll notice here that back in 2003, 2004, employee benefit costs were very high. That growth was high on a year-over-year basis. You'll remember that period. And not surprisingly, wage growth was not particularly high during that period, even though the economy was in pretty good shape at that time. And the employers were saying the obvious, which is, I'm having to spend so much on your health care benefits this year versus last year, I can't afford to give you a raise. So even without a raise, the employer was paying more, but the employee wasn't receiving more, and so those people felt badly. No one was happy. Now, if you look at the blue-colored line, your benefit costs are not rising nearly as quickly now. You know, a lot of complaints about the Affordable Care Act, I understand that. And I saw how you voted in the last election, so I get some sense of this audience. But the fact of the matter is, a lot of the predictions made about the Affordable Care Act, that healthcare costs would skyrocket, healthcare spending would skyrocket, actually have not transpired. Over the last 12 months, healthcare inflation has been around 2%. You can see some of that reflected in this benefit cost data. This purple colored line here is wages and salaries. True enough, you might have heard of this, wages and salaries on a year-over-year basis are growing at their fastest pace in 6 years. That's true. So there is some evidence of wage inflation. However, that's still just 2.1% year-over-year. Not adjusted for inflation. 2.1%. And so wage growth continues to be slow. I'll talk more about this as I go through the presentation. Now, despite what I've said thus far, and it has not been that uplifting what I've said thus far, it'll get better. But it is recovering. And don't think otherwise. The U.S. economy is in recovery. And I'll talk more about other measurements. But there's many ways to look at the fact of recovery. One way is by looking at a map. This map gives you some sense of the hierarchy of performance across the 50 U.S. states and the District of Columbia. The states in blue, like our own state of Maryland, are still recovering. Now notice, no one's in recession, no one's at risk of recession, so everyone's moving forward. We are recovering. What does that mean? Maryland has not fully recovered, and Carroll County has not fully recovered. We'll talk more about that in a moment as well, but Jack Lyburn quoted the unemployment rate for this county at 4.9%. What was it in 2007? 3.0%. So a lot of Maryland is recovering, has not fully recovered, and that's what that says. Those blue-colored states are still recovering. We'll talk more about Maryland in a moment. The states in green, including our neighbor to the east, Delaware, but the states in green are expanding. What does that mean? These states have more than fully recovered from the Great Recession. These state economies have never been bigger. The long key dimensions like home prices and unemployment rates, these states are back. And no state has performed as well. I said this last year, I said this the year before, I said this the year before that, as that state right there, that of course is North Dakota. Now, you know that that's North Dakota. Not a lot of Americans actually know that that's North Dakota. I mean, if you showed them on that, they have no idea. I had somebody in an audience recently, and this is not a joke, tell me, I said, what state is that? They said, that is South Dakota. I said, that's impossible. It's impossible that that's South Dakota. In any case, that's the Bakken Shale Formation, that's oil production. Now, not every community produces oil, of course, but it still manages to be a national story. In 2012, the American people produced around 6.5 million barrels of oil per day. 1 year later, we produced 7.5 million barrels of oil per day. Last year, we produced 8.7 million barrels of oil per day. I know what you're thinking, oil prices have fallen, production must be falling. Probably it will. But the standing forecast from the U.S. Energy Department is for 9.3 million barrels of oil production this year and 9.5 million barrels of oil next year. Probably will not turn out to be true, but nonetheless gives you some sense of the momentum. Now, you know, no surprise that states like North Dakota have done very well in that kind of environment. In 2012, North Dakota surpassed Alaska in terms of aggregate oil production. And it's not just about oil, of course. There's all kinds of natural resources. And this is our natural resource belt right here. No surprise, these states have tended to lead the recovery, to be at the vanguard of the economic recovery. Utah, last year, produced around 37.3 million barrels of oil. That was high by their standards. Colorado, here in green, also a natural resource intensive state. Last year, Colorado was number one in marijuana, number six in natural gas, number nine in oil production. When those people were not completely baked, they produced 63.2 million barrels of oil last year, Colorado, an all-time record for their state. Texas, by the way, Texas is both number one in oil and natural gas. Now, let's keep the story moving. That's, of course, not where the story ends. Nations that produce competitive energy, meaning in terms of price, let's say price in terms of kilowatt hour, are more likely to attract industrial production dollars as well. One of the, you know, Jack Lyburn said a few things, all of them good, all of them fabulous, but I think the most important thing he said was that manufacturing is expanding in Carroll County. And as you know, there's only a handful of jurisdictions in Maryland that have a significant manufacturing heritage. Washington County is one, Carroll County is one, Cecil County, Dorchester County, and there's a couple of others. But this is very important. And one of the things that we have noticed is that industrial production has been surging in America since mid-2009. True enough, the last few months have not been that great, and I'll talk about the last few months economically in a moment. But the point is, energy production and industrial production have been at the vanguard of U.S. economic expansion, and that, generally speaking, is not the Maryland economic story. We're energy users. We're not major industrial producers. Only about 4% of our workers works in manufacturing. The national average is 8%. Nonetheless, you can see here, this is a really good story, and of course, the broadest indication of U.S. economic progress is growth in gross domestic product. And here we see progress as well. Now, admittedly, this recovery, though now approaching the beginning of its seventh year, has not been a forceful or vigorous recovery. It's been basically a 2% recovery. So 2010 was the first full year of economic expansion in America. That year, America expanded 2.5%. The next year, 1.6%. The next year, 2.3%. And the next year, 2.2%. Last year, 2.4%. And how do you get to 2% growth year after year after year? It's very simple. Good quarter, bad quarter, good quarter, bad quarter, good quarter, bad quarter. Very simple. A lack of sustained momentum. And there have been a lot of head fakes during this recovery. Periods during which we thought, the recovery is about to take off. This recovery is going to become a more normal recovery. We're going to see the kind of vigor that we have seen from previous economic recoveries, particularly from significant recessions. Only to be disappointed with the next quarter of data, and we've seen that repeatedly. Now, I might be falling for a head fake now, but I really think 2015 is shaping up to be quite a good year for the U.S. economy. I'll talk more about the forecast for 2015, but I think we're on our way to a certain extent. Now, to see some of this indication of momentum, let's just look at the last three quarters of data in terms of GDP. So that quarter right there is the second quarter of 2014. You see that quarter right there? During that quarter, the U.S. economy expanded 4.6% on an annualized basis, right there, 4.6%. Oh yeah, but we had previous quarters like that earlier in the cycle, only to be disappointed, so the key was follow through. Now, I went to India for the holidays this last Christmas season. I went to India for the holidays at the request of my wife to visit my in-laws. So that was no holiday, and that was no request. And so I cheerfully left these shores on December 18th of 2014. At that time, the Bureau of Economic Analysis, which supplies us with our GDP estimates, was suggesting that the U.S. economy expanded 3.5% on an annualized basis during the third quarter of last year. But upon my triumphant return, my joyful return to these shores on January 5th of 2015, I learned that the BEA had revised upward during my absence their estimate for third quarter GDP to 5.0%. So we 4.6%, 5.0%, two good quarters in a row. Now, admittedly, the fourth quarter of last year was weaker, just 2.2%. But remember, during that quarter, we had the West Coast port slowdown, which, by the way, the media completely undercovered. Anything that subtracts more than a full percentage point from GDP for an entire quarter should receive massive amounts of attention. The media almost missed it completely. There was more attention paid to a particular photograph of Kim Kardashian that ordered by the media than there was on the West Coast ports alone. Despite the fact that that picture only cost the US economy 0.5% of GDP through lost productivity growth. In any case, the point is, even with that, this 9-month period represented the best 9 months of the US economic recovery to date. And we bring that momentum forward into 2015. Now, you might ask the question, well, Anima, what's driving the US economy forward? Where is the growth? I'll now do something that basically assures, or might ensure, that this will be my final time speaking in Carroll County on your behalf, that you will not invite me back again. I'm going to break down GDP into its constituent components. You all learn from school the equation y plus c plus I plus g plus e minus m. So that's all I'm showing you here, and you are welcome. This is a great way to start the week. So why, and I know we have people, students from the Academy of Finance here, and McDaniel College is represented nicely here, so they know this, but why is the way that we Americans abbreviate output? And we measure output in many different ways, as it turns out. You might remember growing up, many of us talked about gross national product. Today we talk about gross domestic product. So two measures of the same thing. In fact, the GDP measure is probably preferable. But the point is, let's stick with GDP. So Y is output. Now, output equals the uses of output. You do not provide your services or distribute your products for no reason. You do it because somebody's going to benefit from the provision of those goods and services. And so output Y equals the uses of output, and there's various categories of users of output. The one we think of often are the consumers. So Y equals C. What's C? Personal consumption, the first set of bars here. That's consumer spending. Plus I, what's I? Gross investment. This is business investment. It includes private construction. It includes purchases of software, equipment, and inventory accumulation. So that shows up in, Y equals C plus I, consumption plus investment plus G. What's G? Government spending. Government spending. That's public sector spending at every level of government, from federal to municipal, plus E, what's E? Exports, what's produced in this great country but sold abroad, minus M, imports, what's produced abroad but sold in this country, E minus M, parentheses together is net exports, the third set of bars here. Now, how does this slide work? If you just look at the green colored bars here, just the green colored bars, so the green colored bars signify the fourth quarter of last year, the last quarter for which we have GDP data, and you're to add up the numbers attached to these green colored bars, you would get that 2.2%. So all I'm doing for you is I'm decomposing growth, and now the slide becomes very simple to interpret. What has been the most significant and sustained source of US economic expansion, growth and demand, which of course drives growth and output, is personal consumption. This is a consumer-led recovery, that's all that says. This doesn't say much more than that, but this is a consumer-led recovery. Now you've heard this before, this is how we economists demonstrate it. What is it not, if not a government spending-led recovery? You can see that during many recent quarters, government spending is actually subtracted from overall economic growth in America. And that should come as no surprise. In 2011, one of the things that Congress does is it passes the Budget Control Act of 2011. You'll remember the Budget Control Act of 2011. Among other things, it gave us what? The Super Committee. The Super Committee. Now, what did the Super Committee accomplish? Nothing. Imagine it had been an average committee. But the Super Committee was supposed to cut roughly $1 trillion in federal spending over a 10-year period. Their failure to do that by November 23rd of 2011 triggered automatic spending cuts that we know as the sequester sequestration, and those began on March 1st of 2013. And these quarters have all been impacted by post-sequestration events or sequestration-related events. So government spending, even though this includes state and local government, government spending has not been a driver of economic growth. Neither has net exports. And this should not surprise you either. The global economy has been weak, halting, erratic. So foreign consumers, foreign businesses do not have the wherewithal necessarily to buy our products. And something else has happened recently that's made it that much more difficult for foreigners to buy our goods and services. What is that? Our US dollar has gotten much stronger. So this morning as we wake up, 1 euro will only buy $1.06. It wasn't that long ago that 1 euro was worth $1.38. Today, your $1 can buy 121 yen. It wasn't that long ago that $1 could buy only 100 yen. The US dollar versus the Canadian dollar, another example. Just a parable, a brief one. I remember I visited Vancouver, British Columbia, Canada several years ago on holiday. And my visit was ill-timed. At that time, the Canadian dollar was worth more than the US dollar. And I remember the arrogance of the merchants as I walked along Robson Street, which is the main tourist thoroughfare in downtown Vancouver. As I walked into their stores, and for some reason they could tell I was an American, they looked at me and said, you know what, our currency is stronger than yours, we have Celine Dion, you only have Wayne Gretzky who now lives in Los Angeles. So we're winning 2-1. That's the Canadian mind, that's who we live next to. Today, Wayne Gretzky also has a place in Arizona. Moreover, and more importantly, your $1 can now buy $1.25 Canadian. The dollar's gotten a lot stronger. It makes it easier for us, by the way, to buy imported products, including gasoline, to the extent that that relates to imported oil. And it makes it harder for our exporters to compete. One of the companies, if you look at fourth quarter corporate earnings, one of the companies that got hammered by the stronger US dollar is Procter & Gamble. If you looked at Procter & Gamble's corporate earnings, the management team said, look, earnings are very disappointing. No matter how many efficiencies we built into Procter & Gamble during the fourth quarter of last year, we could not overcome the impact of the stronger US dollar. And Procter & Gamble has almost a mirror image of itself in Europe. It's called Unilever. It sells almost exactly the same types of products. And Unilever just wiped the slate clean with Procter & Gamble. No surprise, the dollar is stronger, our products are less competitive. So net exports will continue not to be a driver of economic growth. Now, gross investment on occasion has driven economic growth, but a lot of that, you see that big 2.9 there in the second quarter of 2014, that was because of a big inventory build. And why were they building up inventories in the middle part of last year? To sell to consumers, in many cases. And so what this says is this is a consumer-led recovery. What does the consumer need to keep driving this forward? They need a job. Now, you remember during the downturn, Jack certainly remembers that when he would visit various job sites or employment sites, he would see fewer people working, fewer bodies there than had been there the previous month, quarter, or year. The bodies were being snatched. But the pendulum has swung away from that pit. If the pit was the Great Recession, the pendulum has swung away from that. We're now adding jobs at a pretty good clip. Now, true enough, we just got a disappointing jobs number. So in March, the most recent jobs number that we received, the nation only managed 126,000 net new jobs. It was the worst performance since December of 2013, very much undershot expectations. The Wall Street had been expecting around 200,000 to 250,000 jobs added for the month. The number came in at 126. It is subject to revision. And for whatever reason, March is statistically tend to disappoint. For whatever reason, the Bureau of Labor Statistics data for March tend to disappoint. So it's one number, important not to make too much of it, but it did alarm some people, I must make it clear. But that said, over the last year, job creation has been pretty good. Our nation's added 3.128 million jobs over the past 12 months. Not bad. And you can see sort of the impact of the consumer in a lot of these things. The consumer is a major consumer of professional services. Accounting services, for instance, fall into that category. This sector includes retail trade. So retail trade, wholesale trade, transportation, utilities. Of course, retail trade is largely driven by the consumer. Education, health services. Health services, of course, largely driven by the consumer. Leisure and hospitality, those hotels and restaurants. And you can see the consumer spending. Somebody said to me this morning, boy, the restaurants are busy. The restaurants don't seem to have skipped a beat in Carroll County. And that's where I see the greatest appetite, by the way, for Americans to spend, pun intended. The full-service restaurants. That's where I see Americans spending most freely. Go tonight to an Applebee's. Now, don't eat there. You're better than that. But go to a couple perspective for primary research. It'll be busy. As will the Olive Garden next door, the steaks up the street. The Chipotle's will be slammed, I can assure you. I even saw someone last week go into a Red Lobster. So the consumer's pretty engaged with this economy. The other thing about this is that, people have complained, said, okay, we've been adding jobs, but the quality of jobs we've been adding has not been particularly good. And that's been true for most of this recovery until very recently. Because we have now seen a real pickup in job creation in construction, manufacturing, finance, and local government, which is partially reflected in this segment, and that those sectors create a lot of middle-income jobs, hence you're starting to see some wage pressures, some growth in average hourly earnings. Maryland, much better. In some sense, too much better, to the point where I don't believe the data so much. But let me walk through this. So last year, when we had this, if you compared February of 2013 versus February of 2014, so a year ago, I would have told you that Maryland, over that 1 year period, February 2014, added 5,700 jobs. 5,700. Today, 1 year later, February 2015, the Bureau of Labor Statistics is telling us 46,000. So we went from 5,700 to 46,000. That's too good in some sense. Now, we got folks from DBED here, a lot of them right here at this table, and they say, no, Anibad, that's right. We did that. We did that for you. Maybe. That's just part of the story, no question. My very strong feeling is that you might remember the winter back in February of 2014. What that did was it really suppressed employment levels in February of 2014. So it made the February 2013 versus 14 comparison look worse, and it makes the February 14, 2015 comparison look artificially good. That said, there's no question Maryland's economy is in better shape now than it was a year ago. And you can see, mimicking the nation, job growth in education, health services, professional business services, local government dominates this, retail, trade, so on and so forth. So not bad. Here's Baltimore Metro. Now, Baltimore Metro is home to 2.8 million people. Our state is home to almost exactly 6 million people. So Baltimore Metro, our metropolitan area, and of course Carroll County is part of the Baltimore metropolitan area. This region represents slightly less than half of Maryland's population, but more than half of its job growth over the past year. 26,200 of Maryland's 46,000 jobs added over the past year. So this, and you can see it coming back to life, not just in Westminster, but in downtown Columbia, Towson, Owings Mills, Hunt Valley, Harbor Point, Harbor East in the city, Remington, Hamden, so on and so forth. The region is coming back to life. And I think one of the reasons for this, by the way, is that more young people are moving to this region. And remember, a lot of these young people, they have student debt. You know, they don't want to live with their parents forever necessarily, and they have student debt, so what do they want to find? They want to find a place where their dollar will stretch a bit further. And relative to Washington, you can stretch your dollar further in Baltimore. I think we are getting a lot. And you know, in economic development, so much attention is given to attracting young people. Right? Theoretically, young people are a beautiful thing. When you meet them, they're as annoying as can be. But you know, theoretically, they're wonderful. I mean, when you meet them, they're horrific. Horrible people. Horrible. Now, one of the other things about it is the Washington metropolitan area, which of course got really hard hit by sequestration, in the last year, there also we see improvement. And again, this matters for Carroll County, even though Carroll County is not part of the Washington metropolitan area. I mean, it's not the primary school area. Of course, many people from this county commute into Washington Metro for their jobs. And so if you're looking at income tax receipts for the county and other things, Washington Metro matters, and Washington Metro has come back to life. 52,000 jobs added over the past year. Now, Washington Metro includes areas in Virginia, West Virginia, and the District of Columbia, of course. So these are not just all Maryland jobs, naturally. But nonetheless, we have seen the two major metropolitan areas that shape life in Carroll County, economic life in Carroll County, come back to life over the past year. Employment growth across the 50 U.S. states, Maryland ranks 23rd in percentage job growth over the past year. Middling performer. When I came last year, we were in the 40s, now 23rd. Now again, I think the number is overstated. I think the year-over-year comparisons will get worse over the next few months. That's my prediction. I could turn out to be wrong, but we'll see. But the point is, we can, I think, say pretty safely, Maryland's economy is in better shape than it was a year ago. Number one state, by the way, in terms of percentage job creation now is Utah. Utah, fabulous quality of life, attracting a lot of young people. Silicon Valley increasingly putting their back office operations in Utah. They also produce a significant amount of oil. Second is North Dakota. Third is Georgia. Fourth is Florida. Oh, Florida. By the way, to the extent that Maryland loses wealth because we tax both estate and inheritance, for instance, we don't treat retirement income very well in our state. I don't know if you know this. But we don't treat, there's only two states in the country that have both an estate tax and inheritance tax, us and New Jersey. And when you're in a league by yourself in New Jersey, you've got issues. And if you look at IRS data, when Marylanders of means, high net worth leave, they disproportionately leave for Florida. So let me take a little time to talk about Florida. You may or may not realize this, but we economists do not have a great reputation for forecasting accuracy. So when we get one right, we're going to tell you about it. And I've been telling, and I told this audience many years ago, I remember. I said, do yourselves a favor, buy some real estate in Florida. And to drive home the point, I had said that is an American, as baseball, apple pie, mom and Toyota, to take advantage of Floridian, to exploit them at their most vulnerable, to take away their homes if you can do it. And I urge you to do it. I begged you to do it. And some of you did the right thing. You swept in there like vultures and took away people's homes and put them out on the street, and I salute you as American capital. And finally, you did the morally ambiguous thing. You did nothing. Shame on you. The point is this. You know, those housing markets that were really distressed, there are five states that suffered the most during the foreclosure crisis. Florida, Georgia, Arizona, Nevada, California. You'll find all five of those states in this first column in terms of percentage job growth. Those housing markets have stabilized. In fact, you see a lot of construction now in both Tampa and Miami, and those states now are, again, you know, among the fastest recovers. Colorado at number six. And by the way, you see the District of Columbia legalizing marijuana, or at least decriminalizing it. But one of the reasons this is happening is that people look at Colorado and say, okay, you legalized first, and your state is not falling apart. In fact, you've turned it into a tourism industry. And by the way, you know, the people who do that kind of activity, they don't hurt anybody. They're indoors most of the time, and they're basically dead all day. So it doesn't bother me one bit, frankly. Now, this is the unemployment rates of the 50 U.S. states. We have the February data now. Maryland at 5.5%, I think Jack said 5.6%. It's 5.5%, according to my data, tied with the national average, 5.5%, tied with the nation. Now, that's not good, by the way. Being tied with the nation is not good if you're Maryland. You know, if you're Tennessee, that's fine. But we're Maryland. So who are we? We're among the most educated people in the country. We're among the most affluent people in the country. Nobody does as well as our kids on advanced placement exams. Nobody. You know, our schools are often ranked as number one in the country. You know, Maryland is a very special place. And typically our unemployment rate is much below the national average. So in late 2010, November to be precise, our state's unemployment rate was 2.1 percentage points below the national average. Today it's tied. The advantage vis-a-vis the balance of the country has been eroded, and that's because for 3 years, the 3 years that followed the Budget Control Act of 2011, and ultimately sequestration, our economy has underperformed. Now our economy coming back to life, but still unemployment rate equal to the national average. The lowest unemployment rate is in Nebraska, at 2.7%, followed by North Dakota, South Dakota, Utah, all natural resource intensive states. This unemployment rate is the largest 20 metropolitan areas in the country. And, you know, you look at Baltimore Metro, and the unemployment rate is 5.8%. So that doesn't sound very good. That's 12th. That's 12th, you know, out of the 20. 12th lowest. That's not very good. The lowest is in Minneapolis. But again, one of the reasons I think our unemployment rate has been stubbornly high regionally is that people are moving into this region. Young people are moving to the region to do their job search. People who have previously moved to Montgomery County or Prince George's County are choosing Anne Arundel County and Howard County and Carroll County now, disproportionately. I think that's a wonderful thing, all kidding aside. And I think that's one of the reasons our unemployment rate is actually a bit sticky at 5.8%. This is our unemployment rates for the 24 jurisdictions in Maryland. Carroll County, 4.9%, as I said earlier. The lowest is in Howard County, 4%, followed by Montgomery County. And again, notice the impact of the federal government on these unemployment rates by jurisdiction. So unemployment is by place of residence. So if you live in Ellicott City, Howard County, and you work for NIH in Bethesda, and many people do, you are, for purposes of these statistics, counted as Howard County. It's by place of residence. So a lot of people who live in Howard County works for the federal government or works for a federal government contractor. Montgomery County is a Washington, D.C. area, so as is Howard County. And Arundel County, of course, heavily shaped by federal government for George G. Meade. Carroll County, you in Carroll County can commute with equal difficulty into Baltimore or Washington. And so you participate in one of the deepest labor markets in the entire country. Frederick County, of course, a Washington, D.C. area suburb. Charles County is as well. Queen Anne's County is basically a suburb of Anne Arundel County. People hate when I say this, by the way, but it's true. I say it to the Chamber of Commerce, and they hate when I say it. I say, hey, look, what can I do? It is who you are. St. Mary's County, of course, 22,000 people on base at the Patuxent River Naval Air Station. Prince George's County is in Washington, D.C. area suburb. Harford County is home to the Aberdeen Proving Ground. And then Baltimore County is home to Social Security Administration and the Center for Medicare and Medicaid Services. Federal government. Who do you have in the right-hand column? Mostly Maryland's Eastern Shore. Worcester County, Somerset County, Dorchester County, Wicomico County, Kent County, Cecil County, Carroll County, Talbot County. And one of the reasons for that is that we are exporting wealth. So people who once upon a time would have retired in Talbot County say, I'll retire to Sussex County, Delaware instead, because they treat retirement income more favorably. Or to someplace in Pennsylvania, or to Florida, or Tennessee, or other places that treat retirement income favorably. Now, To be fair, the General Assembly last year dealt with the estate tax to a certain extent. Over the course of 5 years, roughly now, 5 years, we'll get to the federal government thresholds in terms of federal estate tax or state estate tax impact. But it was sort of ham-handed in its in handling. It shouldn't take 4 or 5 years to get there. And we still, for right now, are not a favorable place in which to retire for, again, high net worth. High net worth. By the way, those are people who want to keep. They pay a ton of taxes, even in retirement, you want to keep, and they don't cause but trouble. Whatever trouble they caused was when they were working. They don't cause much trouble after they're retired. This is Carroll County's unemployment rate over time. You can see the progress, but you can see back in 2007, we were around 3% right here. So, you know, just give you some sense, but we have made progress. And then let me talk about the housing market. Now, almost hitting the home stretch here, only two sections of the presentation, I promise. Then I'll take some questions. But I want to talk about the housing market. I always do this, I think many people have some interest in the housing market. We do have a fair number of realtors here. Mm-hmm. So here's our situation. Let's take a step back. We're adding, or have been, March notwithstanding, 250,000 jobs a month plus. We've added over 3 million jobs over the past 12 months nationally. We have unemployment rate nationally now neatly below 6%. We have very high asset prices. Dow Jones, S&P, NASDAQ are at or near record highs. And we have really cheap money. We have a 30-year fixed mortgage rate less than 4% and a 15-year fixed mortgage rate of around 3%. And as I said to a group of realtors recently, I said, we economists cannot do anything more for you. We've given you high asset prices and job creation. We've in fact improved the quality of jobs being added by the US economy, and we've given you cheap money. It's now your turn to do something, realtor. And you would think, given all of these factors at work, all these factors that would, all things being equal, affect housing positively, would have a housing boom in this country right now, an owner-occupied housing boom. We don't. This is U.S. new home sales. Jeez. People say, yeah, U.S. new home sales are lower than they were during this bubble period. That's true. Yeah, so that doesn't surprise me, except look at this. U.S. new home sales are below what they were pre-boom. This is back in 1999. This is 1999. We're not even at 1999 levels yet. This is not just about getting back to the bubble. This is actually about getting back to the pre-boom levels. And when you don't have a lot of new home sales, you don't have a ton of housing starts. This is U.S. housing start data. I just want to focus on the blue shade area. The blue shade area here is single-family housing starts. Right here, that's single-family. This yellow, that's multifamily. That's mostly apartments. You know, where do you see the momentum here? Where is the growth? It's in this yellow section. It's multifamily. So we've got these high asset prices and this cheap money, and what's booming? The apartment market. That's what makes economics so difficult to forecast. Nothing ever fits. It's the apartment market that's booming. I mean, you can see it real right here. This is U.S. home ownership. Back in the second quarter of 2007, our home ownership rate was 69.2% in this country. We just got fourth quarter data, 63.9%. And from the perspective of home ownership, it's as if the 90s and the 2000s never occurred. We're back to home ownership of the 1980s. And before that, the 1960s. You can really see it here. The mirror image is right here. This is private new multifamily construction. You see how that's really surged back? That's mostly apartments. Why is this happening? So many reasons. Student debt, of course. $1.2 trillion in outstanding student debt in this country. So young people already have a mortgage even before they try to buy a residence. It's actually hard to get a mortgage than it used to be. You might remember the headlines from a few months ago. Ben Bernanke denied a mortgage. That actually didn't happen. There's somebody out there that got a mortgage application from a Dr. Ben S. Bernanke and said, you know what, this is America, that's denied. It's not good enough to be former Federal Reserve Chairman. Former is not good enough. You're a consultant now. You're on your own. You'll get a mortgage eventually. Don't worry. He knows people. But the point is, what chance does a typical 20 or 30-something have? Down payment requirements are stiffer than they were for most categories of borrowers several years ago. And of course, there's a role of culture. We economists do not like to talk about culture. It's squishy. It's hard to measure. But culture clearly affects economic outcomes. And these young people of today do not seem to aspire to asset accumulation the way that we did when we were young, many of us. My generation is Generation X. One of the movies of my generation was Wall Street. It was came out in 1989, starring Michael Douglas and Charlie Sheen. Michael Douglas playing the role of Gordon Gekko, corporate raider Gordon Gekko. And in that movie, Gordon Gekko famously says, greed is good. And my generation said, yes, that's right. This is all about asset accumulation. One of the reasons that we had the 2000 housing market boom is my generation was all in. We could not wait to buy homes, and in fact, more than one. We were the flippers, the rehabbers, the speculators, so on and so forth. That was our generation. And we helped to power that housing market bubble. Today's young people, the 20-somethings of today, Generation Y, don't seem to be that way. They don't seem to aspire for asset accumulation. They rent their bicycles. The only thing they seem to own are those Beats audio headphones, and I'm pretty sure those are borrowed.
That's what they do
and it's not just a decision whether or not to rent or buy a dwelling unit. If you look at driver's license data, take a deep dive into driver's license data. You'll see that young people, 16 or 17-year-olds, are not getting driver's license to the same extent that we did when we turned 16 or 17. Sir, when you and I turned 16, what's the first thing we wanted? That's not right, as it turns out. You're forgetting. That's really embarrassing for you. But the car was in the top two, and my point is, if you're not getting a driver's license, what does that tell me? You're not about to buy a car. Now, this thing is going to change. Not immediately. It's still going to be a multifamily apartment-led boom, and we know that from housing permits data. Again, blue shade area, single-family building permits. Single-family, that's not where the boom is, clearly. It's multifamily, a lot of apartments, probably too many apartments that will ultimately be constructed. But it's going to change over the next 10 years. Why? Generation Y, we spend a lot of time talking about Generation Y because they're the largest U.S. generation and the most educated generation in U.S. history. They're our future and they're a bright future. Today, they're between the ages of 16 and 35. So the central tendency of that generation is in the low to mid-20s. So many of them would be renters under most circumstances. In 10 years, they're between the ages of 26 and 45. Central tendency, therefore, becomes in the low to mid-30s. Well, a lot happens during those magical 10 years. People have children, get married, often in that order. And all of a sudden, renting may not be your best option. And one of the things you'll hear, by the way, about young people, and I'm stereotyping a lot, but I'm stereotyping, I think, accurately. One of the things you'll hear about young people a lot is, Anibug, people say to me, Anibug, they love the cities, these young kids. These young kids love the city. Of course, they can't drive. In 10 years, you better know how to drive because you have kids, and there's soccer practice, and sometimes even occasionally, school. So, and the other thing about it is the investor motivation is returning to housing. Home prices are now rising in much of the country. So when we were growing up, the housing market had a track record of wealth creation. So we took it as axiomatic that buying a home was a good idea. It's going to be a good investment. These young people do not have the luxury to feel that way. They've seen home prices rise, of course, but they've also seen them collapse. But as the housing market continues to reestablish its track record for wealth creation, not destruction, you'll see more young people moving, in fact, into homes and moving, in fact, into the suburbs. Now, in Carroll County, sales prices are still down on a year-over-year basis. It's interesting. We see this everywhere. On a year-over-year basis, prices are down. It's a median sales price for Carroll County. Not significantly, but one of the things is people are looking for small square footage. And also, we still have some of the impact from distressed properties, still, you know, foreclosures hitting the market and driving down the statistic. But unit sales are up nicely. If you look at Carroll County housing unit sales, those are up nicely. In fact, 25% between February 2014 and February 2015. So they're not, people aren't necessarily looking at the highest end of the market where we still see resistance. But people are buying homes, those low mortgage rates are making their impact felt. This is Carroll County new housing permits. Not a lot being built here. Not a lot being built here. That's what that says. At least not compared to earlier in the cycle. Now, here we are, the final section of my presentation, the forecast. What have I titled that for you? The psycho, of course. Why? Because you're a psycho if you think I can forecast. You know, I've done this 14 years, and I've proven over the course of more than a decade, I just can't do it. But to be fair to myself, I have not fallen for the head fakes. I've never given you, at least not in recent years, an overly optimistic forecast. I always thought the recovery from the recession was going to be a very shallow one. I thought we're going to create a lot of part-time jobs, create a lot of part-time jobs. I thought unemployment rates would stay stubbornly high, interest rates would stay stubbornly low. That's exactly what we've got. As I said, I might be falling for a head fake now, but I think we're going to have a good year. We're not going to get to, I don't think we're going to get to 3% growth, by the way. If we did, it would be the first time since 2005 when the U.S. economy expanded 3.4%. But we'll have a good year. Probably the best year of the economic recovery cycle thus far. My forecast around 2.7, 2.8% GDP growth for the year. And it's going to be a consumer-led recovery. The heavy lift has got to come from the consumer. But why shouldn't it, ask yourself? Some of you will point out to me, Anibug, isn't it true that retail sales have been disappointing for the last 3 months? That's true. And I think weather plays a large part in that. A large part. But even with that, the last 2 months being weak, on a year-over-year basis, we see some momentum in retail sales. The consumer was spending before, remember, when we were adding fewer jobs, jobs of lower quality, and gasoline prices were higher. Fuel prices are now lower, and we're adding more jobs again, March notwithstanding, and better quality jobs. And we see wage growth. So if you look here, internet retailers, their sales are up 8.6% on a year-over-year basis. That's a strong number. Food service and drinking places. This is a fancy way of saying restaurants and bars. So what you call restaurants and bars, we call food service and drinking places. But that's up 7.7%. Big number. In fact, you can see the American lifestyle right on this chart. So what do? We wake up, we get online and start shopping, texting, and tweeting. And then we go to a bar and start drinking. And now we're drinking, driving, because we get to our car then and start drinking, driving, texting, and tweeting. And eventually go to a healthcare store. That's the American lifestyle pretty clearly right there. It's nothing to be proud of, by the way, but it does drive a $17 trillion economy. The index of leading economic indicators is still positive. It's been a wildly predictive index, fantastic. Printed the recession, printed the end of the recession, and told us that, you know, this was going to be a halting recovery, sporadic, erratic recovery. Up, down, good quarter, back quarter, good quarter, back quarter. But more recently, we've seen consistent positive readings. The index, this is the percentage change in the index value. So this negative slope here should not concern you. The index is still going up in value. This is a percentage change. And so the index is telling us, hey, leading indicators are in good shape. We should be fine for 2015. So the economy came, gained momentum over the course of last year. Telltale Heart, by the way, a short story by Edgar Allan Poe, first published in 1843. But the economy gained momentum over the course of last year. We bring that momentum forward. The tailwinds are still there. Low gasoline prices, strong stock market, low interest rates. Monetary policy is clearer this year than it was last year. You say, no, that's not right, Anibon. You're wrong about that. Because everyone's wondering when Janet Yellen is going to start increasing interest rates, including the bankers at the front table here. Everyone's wondering about that. True enough, but remember last year we had to deal with the end of QE3, the end of the third round of quantitative easing, and no one could really figure out what that meant. And the presumption was that interest rates were really going to take off, at least during that period when they were winding down QE3, and certainly after. In fact, interest rates are falling. So today, as I got up, the 10-year Treasury is yielding 1.97%, the rate at which the Federal Reserve borrows on a 10-year basis. The 5-year Treasury has got up here, 1.42%. Interest rates are low. Here's the thing. In Japan, they're even lower. The 10-year this morning was yielding 0.33%. So we're 1.97, Japan 0.33. The Germans, 0.18. So what happened last year, the Europeans and Japanese, their interest rates went down, our interest rates fell in sympathy. And my view is our interest rates really don't take off until their interest rates start to rise, and that's a ways away. Because Europeans are just not beginning their own version of quantitative easing. So, you know, Janet Yellen, my guess is, will start raising, and the Federal Open Market Committee will start raising interest rates this year. But the interest rates at which we transact will generally stay low. Now, it's an optimistic forecast, the most optimistic I've delivered to you in many years. We'll see if it comes true. If it doesn't, I just won't come back. But obviously, there's all kinds of threats right out there, things that no economist or anybody can foresee, the so-called black swan threats. Black swan is a term of art given to us by a gentleman named Nassim Nicholas Taleb, a scholar of the highest rank. His book is entitled The Black Swan, and the subtitle is The Impact of the Highly Improbable. So a black swan event is a highly improbable event that, if it were to occur, can change the trajectory of economies and financial markets. And you can have positive black swan events, by the way. I'll give you an example. Seahawks throw on second down. From the perspective of the Patriots, that's a positive black swan event. No one saw that coming. And now here I'm listing for you some negative black swan events. I won't go through all of them. And the list is endless, right? You know, you've got the Russians right now acting very crazily, even toward U.S. aircraft. The Chinese disputing with the Japanese, a set of islands. 60 Minutes did a story on that yesterday. So all kinds of things. But for right now, the U.S. economy is in good shape, absent black swan threats. The market has been nervous. Stock market has been really jittery. Volatility is up. And the jitter just started when oil prices started to fall. That should not make the markets nervous. Despite all the progress we've made in terms of producing oil, and I'm set aside the environmental issues. I understand there's environmental issues. But we have made progress in terms of producing oil as a country, but we're still a net importer of oil, as it turns out. So lower oil prices, all things being equal, are good for us. What the market should be nervous about, that strong U.S. dollar. Because that really is affecting particularly large cap U.S. stocks. You'll see more of that over the course of the year. My view is Merrill's economy will continue to underperform despite DBED's best efforts, despite the fact that we have a new governor, despite the fact that we have more, I think, an improving business climate in Maryland, because we still haven't seen the full impact of the state government cutbacks yet. Remember, we entered the legislative session with roughly a $1.2 billion shortfall between FY15 and FY2016. A lot of that is yet to show up in the data. When that does, I think you'll see Maryland's performance come down just a notch relative to the country, but we'll still have our best year in many years. And Carroll County also will continue to progress for reasons we've gone through. I thank you very much for the opportunity to be with you today. It's been a privilege. I hope this was enjoyable. Thank you very much. Question is, what is the outlook over 1, 3, 5, 10 years for the biotech life sciences sector, maybe of the U.S. economy or Maryland's economy? It is very positive, very, very positive, more positive than it probably should be. I'll tell you why. You know, our story in Maryland has been one of the lack of commercialization, as you know, home to NIH and FDA and Johns Hopkins, and people have actually written doctoral theses about why it is that Maryland does not spin out as many life sciences companies. For instance, you know, I asked the front table, name me one life sciences company spun out of Johns Hopkins. Go ahead. Nothing, right? Not buckets. Can you imagine? So if I asked the same question in Boston and was, you know, asked about MIT, or I went to, you know, Northern California and asked about Stanford, name me some, they'd be able to name dozens of biotech companies, potentially. Why has there been this lack of spin-off? And it's because, well, a number of reasons. Part of this institutional culture. So at Stanford, it's about commercialization and creating billionaires, at least it has been in recent decades. Johns Hopkins is about publishing in peer-reviewed journals. So we want to publish, but we're not trying to turn this, and in fact, there's been some thinking at Johns Hopkins and similar situated institutions that if we introduce the profit motive into our research, we bias the research. And in fact, a friend of mine who manages a lab, runs a lab, a Stanford postdoc, at Johns Hopkins said, you know, for the first time in my career, because he's trying to commercialize his technology, I care about the outcome of this experiment, and that's dangerous. So there's something to this, and I don't want to, you know, but the point is, for 20 years now, roughly, since about 1995, 1996, when Hopkins started Line Pharmaceuticals, these institutions have been looking to try to get into the commercialization game, and it takes about 20 years to create that kind of environment. So my very strong feeling is that over the next few years, we're going to see a lot of commercialization in life sciences in Maryland. It'll be a thriving sector of the economy, and we're going to produce a lot of, several publicly traded companies, companies that you can actually buy the stock in, and they're out of Maryland. So watch for that. My outlook, the outlook is very positive. And yes, sir.
I've been reading a lot about the problems with the U.S. dollar in the future due to the lack of confidence in the world market.
Right, so I think your question is about a lack of confidence in the U.S. dollar. Is it about a lack of confidence in the dollar itself? Is that your question? And some talk about the U.S. dollar losing its status as a reserve currency of the world, and that's sort of the notion. So yeah, there has been this discussion that the U.S. dollar would lose this dominant position among the world's currencies, and in particular, the dollar is the global reserve currency. What does that mean? It means that multinational banks, banks that transact globally, tend to hold their reserves disproportionately in the form of US dollar-denominated assets. So because they do that, we're talking about humongous banks, so we're talking about a lot of dollars. Because they hold their reserves in dollar-denominated assets, that increases the value of the dollar because it increases the demand for the dollar. And if you take that away, if all of a sudden those banks are holding their reserves in other currencies, the dollar will plummet in value, our purchasing power will decrease, we'll see inflation, higher interest rates, so on and so forth. That's sort of the notion. The question, though, becomes, what would become the reserve currency if it's not the U.S. dollar? Who are the competitors? The euro, of course, comes to mind. But the euro has even less credibility than the U.S. dollar, because the Europeans have even less credibility than Americans. What about the Japanese yen? Well, my goodness, you might have seen in the 60 Minutes story yesterday, something you've probably already known. Japan is the fastest aging society on the planet, very low birth rates, very slow economic growth for the last two decades, an even larger debt to GDP ratio than America's. So the yen is not a rival either. You might say, well, there's some other great currencies out there, aren't there? The Canadian dollar. Not enough Canadian dollars in global circulation to serve as a global reserve currency. What about the Swiss franc? Ditto. What about the Australian dollar? Ditto. There is one currency out there that one could argue, the British pound, is sort of interesting. But even there, there's not enough in global circulation to, you know, today a British pound can buy $1.46. There's not enough British pounds in the world to serve as a global currency. So in other words, and I like to say it all the time, the dollar is the worst, the US dollar is the worst currency in the world except for all the others. And so we will remain a global reserve currency by default. I don't think that's an issue right now. Any other questions here from this audience? Those are, yes, madam. Question is, how about the concept of a basket of currencies? Too complicated. Right? Too complicated. Because I don't know where my next transaction is coming from. I don't know if it's a big multinational US deal or big. The thing about the dollar is it's accepted everywhere. I'd ask you right now, go out there, try to buy, there's a Starbucks up the street here. Go there and try to buy a latte with euros. Go ahead, do it. Try. You can't do it. But if I was in Europe and I wanted to buy a latte in Europe with a dollar, I could do it. And I can transact in Peru. I can transact anywhere in the world. Anywhere in the world they accept dollars. Some places in the world, by the way, they don't accept dollars. They don't accept even their local currency for transactions. Like in Cuba, that's right. So the point is, too complicated, because the rupee is not accepted everywhere. The euro is not accepted everywhere. The dollar is accepted everywhere. So for now, it is a global reserve currency. Yes, sir.
Staying on the currencies, how about, you didn't mention the Chinese and also the petrodollar.
Yeah, I didn't mention the Chinese currency or the petrodollar. Petrodollar too volatile, and also not probably enough in global circulation, and not very well understood by a lot of bankers. The Chinese currency is managed by, it's a managed currency. It's not a freely floating currency. And I can't, as a banker, have a government control the value of my reserves at a given time. I cannot give up that control. You might say, well, you should not trust the US Treasury either. Yeah, but it's at least a freely floating currency. The dollar can float against other currencies. So it's not managed that way. It cannot be used as a threat against me. It won't be. So that's the reason I didn't even mention the Chinese currency, is because it just cannot be a global reserve currency because it's not a freely floating currency. Any other questions here? These are excellent questions, really, all of them. Any other questions here? Sir?
Is the United States forcing interest rates, keeping them low so we have a recovery here, but ultimately that's going to hurt, kill around the world? And how long can we keep forcing interest rates low?
Right, so the question is two-pronged question. One is, are we forcing interest rates to stay low in America to keep the recovery going? Let me answer that one first. Yes, we are. This is a consumer-led recovery. I mean, you might ask the question, Ivan, you talked about the retail sales growth. How can retail sales be growing if income growth has been so slow? Explain that. Because consumers are taking on debt. Not recently, by the way. Recently, the U.S. savings rate has been rising. So a lot of the money that's been saved from lower gasoline prices has actually showed up in the savings rate. Consumers have yet to spend that money. But if you look at a longer-term history over the course of years, over the course of recovery, savings rates have been declining, and consumers have taken on more debt. Student loans, auto loans. We sold over 17 million cars last month on an annualized basis. Most of those cars aren't paid with cash. They're borrowed. So the consumer's taking on debt, and so they need low interest rates to keep the recovery going. Yes, your next part is, will that sink the world economy? I don't know about the world economy. It'll ultimately sink the U.S. recovery. Because my guess is that when you're approaching the seventh year of economic recovery, and you're maintaining 0% short-term interest rates, you're creating a ton of distortions in financial markets. And we probably have a ton of distortions in financial markets. Now, those don't necessarily manifest themselves immediately. You'll remember we had distortions back in 03, 04, but the housing market didn't really slump until 2006. So you can go on for a few years with those distortions in place, but one of these days, these distortions come back to haunt you. And that's what's going to happen at some point. Not in 2015, but at some point, these distortions will show up in various ways. Repricing of assets, maybe one could argue that these interest rates, there's a lot of combustion there beneath them. One of these days, these interest rates are going to spring higher, and that will be a reflection of when these distortions come to light and become concerning to financial firms. And that'll be the end of the recovery. It'll probably happen sometime before the end of this decade, yeah? But not now. It's not the 2015 story. Any other questions? Do we have time for any more? No, it's totally up to me. You're right, Michael. No, I think about it. Yes, go ahead. It's up to me. Yes.
How do you think the national debt's going to affect things?
Yes, that's a great question, too. Thank you. Yeah, no, don't lie down. So our core question is about the national debt. I didn't talk about that this year, notice. I have talked about it in previous years. It's not the story right now. We have accumulated more than an $18 trillion national debt. Depending upon whom you ask, we have $60 to $128 trillion in future unfunded Social Security and Medicare liabilities. But people still buy our bonds, right? I mean, as I say, the 10-year treasury today, 1.97%. So people are saying, hey, you can pay me less than 2%, I'll still buy your bonds. On the 5-year, 1.42%, you can pay me less than 1.5%, I'll still buy your bonds. So is the investor right now worried about U.S. national debt? They're not. And as I say, you know, Japan's debt to GDP ratio is much larger than ours. People still buy Japanese debt. So the crisis is not in the near term. The crisis is a longer term crisis. You know, is it 10 years, 15 years? You've probably heard the Social Security Trust Fund was insolvent in roughly 2033, 2034. So it's around that period I would be concerned, but we're only in 2015. We should be dealing with this now, of course. We're not, but we should be, and not seriously. But it's not the issue for 2015. I thank you very much for the opportunity. It's been fabulous.
We did a straw vote at the table here, and Chris says he wants you back next year for reunion too, so I guess you're coming back. But Brian, get on his calendar so we can get him back. I want to thank the Portico for hosting us and Salerno's, and the presentation will be at the format probably at the end of the day on our PDF, so if you just go on our website, it'll be there. Have a great day. Remember, Carroll County, now the right place and the right time. Thank you.